So, hello to the very few people that watch my YouTube. While the Middle East is on fire, while America is being led by a man with the mental capabilities of a four-year-old, and while we are in the pre-election stage in Holland for the parties who will lead our country for the next 4 years, I ask the question that plagues humanity since the dawn of time, and that question is, can video games be art? Excuse me. We're looking right now at Double Dragon, a game from 1987, made by Taito Software. A simple side-scroller beat-em-up. And the question here, of course, is this game art? Of course, it is. This isn't art. There is artwork in this game, but as we look at the definition of art from the Oxford Dictionary, we'll read off my little script here. Art is the expression or application of human creative skill and imagination, typically in the visual form, painting, sculptures, photography, and film, producing works to be appreciated primarily for their beauty or emotional power. Well, this game looks good, especially for 1987, and even for today. I mean, the graphics are detailed, the backgrounds are detailed, but it doesn't really move me emotionally. It's all functional art in that matter. But some games can be, in my opinion, I'm not stating facts here, it's just my opinion, can be art. And we will move on to some other games in this video, as you can watch me getting the shit beat out of me by some random dudes. And yeah, of course, there were also some critics who had a few things to say about art. For example, Roger Ebert. This is a quote from 2005. To my knowledge, no one out in the field has ever been able to cite a game worthy of comparison with great dramatists, poets, filmmakers, novelists, and composers. That a game can aspire to artistic performance as a visual experience, I accept. But for most gamers, video games represent a loss of those precious hours we have available to make ourselves more cultural, civilized, and empathetic. Well, of course, Mr. Ebert never played, Fahrenheit, for example, a game that I would consider, well, we'll get to that later. This is a spoiler for the end of the vid, but doesn't matter. So now we're gonna take a look at Grim Fandango, an adventure game from the mid 90s, if I'm not mistaken, made by Double Fine, which is a gaming company that likes to push the boundaries a bit, and they also do that with Grim Fandango. I will shut up now first, so you can listen to the intro and to the dialogue in the intro.
Sorry for the wait, Mr. Flores. I am ready to take you now.
You will hear me later.
Take me where?
Now. There's no need to be nervous.
Nervous? No. Just your appearance. It's a little intimidating.
Intimidating? Me? But I'm your friend. My name's Manny Calavera. I'm your new travel agent.
I don't want a new travel agent. I want to go home.
You can't go home, Celso. You're dead. But you're not alone. Everybody here is just as dead as you. That's why we call it the land of the dead. Are you ready for your big journey?
No. What journey?
The four-year journey of the soul. It is quite a big trip. And I can't lie to you, Celso. It could be very, very dangerous. Unless you were to take that money you were buried with and buy a better travel package from us. I mean, wouldn't you rather cross the land of the dead in your own sports car? Maybe try a luxury ocean cruise? Or, if you led a very good life, you may even be eligible for a ticket on the number 9 itself.
The number 9?
That's our top-of-the-line express train. It shoots straight to the 9th underworld, the land of eternal rest, in 4 minutes instead of 4 years. But very few people qualify. Let's take a look at your records. Well, the
bad news is the train appears to be just out of your reach, but I still got a couple of tricks up my sleeve here. Mm-hmm. Yaha! Yes, that's the ticket. The Excelsior line. Yes, she's a beauty. That compass in the handle will sure come in handy, too. Oh, you're going to have a great trip. Wish I was going.
Why don't you? You could give me a lift.
Oh, I can't leave here until I've worked off a little debt to the powers that be.
Community service, eh? Well, I guess there are some folks worse off than me.
Oh, I'll be leaving here soon enough. No thanks to dead and no commission lowlife cases like yours, Menso.
Hey, Manny. The boss told me to tell you not to leave early tonight. He wants to talk to you about something when he gets back from his trip.
Tell Don not to worry. I'm not going anywhere. Especially not with clients like that. Where do they get these guys? They don't qualify for anything good, so I can't sell anything good. I can't work off my time, and I'm stuck. Stuck selling walking sticks to a bunch of burros for eternity. I need better clients. I need a real saint. I need a lead on a rich, dead saint.
So personally, I wouldn't call this game art yet. It moves me by making me laugh because I love the humor of it. I love the beautiful backgrounds, or well, the is this pre-rendered backgrounds, but they look awesome. The main animation, the characters look awesome. The voice acting is moves me a bit. It's awesome. So this is becoming close to becoming art because it involves you emotionally in this game. And that's what Mr. Ebert seemed to forget, that if you get invested emotionally, you can start by calling it art. Same as you look at a beautiful picture or listen to a beautiful piece of music, you get moved by it. Emotionally, you maybe start to tear up a little, you start to laugh, you start to think about life in general or something. It triggers your mind to do, to think, to react. And from Grim Fandango we go to the dwarves. This game was completely crowdfunded. It was released by THQ Nordic. This game is based on the dwarves novels written by a German author called Markus Heitz.
Snow White face still radiates beauty in terrible contrast to the rest of her appearance. From the neck down, she is nothing more than a blood-red, damp and glistening skeleton. There are long nails sticking through her thin bones, and where her beautiful eyes once were, are now gaping black holes.
And, yeah, this game is of course based on the first book of the Dwarves. The Dwarves, like I said, is a fantasy novel series. Pretty graphic, pretty in your face, pretty gruesome sometimes, as you can see. And
the smell of the smoke has accompanied you for a while now, but here, so close to the bodies, it is masked by the sweet smell of death. You have a bitter taste in your mouth and have to pull yourself together to avoid vomiting in disgust.
I tip my hat off to the to the creators of this game, with a fairly low budget, which most big gaming companies would laugh at. They made an awesome game with awesome artwork, and they follow the book to the letter. I'm not reviewing the game. The gaming-wise, the game could be a bit better, but as for the artwork and the art and the backgrounds, the foregrounds, the character designs, the voice acting, everything in this game is just right. This is art to me. This game is starting becoming art to me.
The hand that painted this picture was that of a master. It is composed exclusively in shades of red, but every single little detail is painstakingly and precisely reflected. Trees, the remains of buildings, bodies. You hesitate.
This picture portrays the village in its state of ruin.
Examining the canvas more closely, you realize that it is actually made of skin. And the red paint seems more than suspicious now.
And this is what I mean with big companies, big gaming companies not taking any risks. Here a risk is taken and they deliver something beautiful and something somewhat new. something great. They of course had the stories of the
elves and their
of the books as a as a as guidance, but they did amazing stuff. I'm not giving away any spoilers on the books or the game. Just download it for yourself for 20 bucks or 20 euros, and you have a 20 or 40. I don't remember. I think it was 20. You have one hell of an experience with this game, and also read the damn books, The Dwarves by Marcus Heitz. And from The Dwarves we go to Street Fighter 4 Alpha, in the day where Capcom actually released games with full content instead of releasing an unfinished game like Street Fighter 5 and later on finishing it up through patches. But I'm talking about the artwork in this game. Immediately my attention goes to the backgrounds of this game, which are crammed with detail, and you can see the love and care the artist put in it in this game. It's finished, it looks for a PlayStation 3 game, it looks amazing in this day still, when you have the new games like, I don't know, Event or what's the game? Dark Horizon or Event Horizon, the new game by Guerrilla, that overhyped, another overhyped shite open world game, nothing new. And you can say, well, Street Fighter is nothing new, but I don't care, I'm done with the overhyped machine, and let's just focus on the on the game at hand, the Street Fighter 4. I'm not going on a rant here because I don't want to. So just take a look at the backgrounds. Like for example, this is India. I think this is the exciting street scene, as it's called. So much stuff in the background, so many things to see. For example, the elephant here with the what is that? Let's call it the cloth on the back. The attention to detail, the movement of everybody, every animal, every person in the background. These backgrounds, I'm not talking about the main characters in front of the backgrounds, but I consider this background to be art. I find it beautiful. And there are hard to find words for this this background, and the most beautiful background will be coming up after I kicked Blanca's ass, his little green ass. There we go. And this is this one, the solar eclipse. I'm just gonna shut up for a little, and you take a look at the background and appreciate for what they do. Just have a little look-see. I will shut up for now. So you saw the hippos coming out of the water. You see the meerkats running around, jumping around, the birds landing on the hippo, the giraffes, the zebras running across the jungle or the savannah. It's one beautiful, beautiful background, and this is it's just beautiful. So this to me is art. I moved by the background, so according to the definition, Mr. Ebert, this is art. If you can see beauty in it, it is art. Or am I wrong here, people? You know, in base, this is just a simple finding game, 2-1-2 finding game, but the way it's presented, it's just takes my breath away sometimes. And here we have Skyrim, of course, the remastered version. I loved the original game, and I had to download the remastered version. And I'm not doing a game review of Skyrim Remastered, but I just wanna... This game was released, I don't know, on the PlayStation 3 a couple of years ago, 7 years ago, six, I don't remember, maybe even 11 years ago. Didn't do my research on this, so don't take my word for it. But, and the only thing the remaster did was add some more lighting, add some more textures, and this game still looks amazing to me. I love the artwork, I love the physics of the water, of the... I just love the overall look of this game. Even for an older game, this still, to me, looks more amazing than most modern open world, high def graphics, shiny, over shiny graphics. I'll have this any day above that. Graphics don't make a good game, graphics don't make the experience any better. If it's done with love and care like this, then I don't have problem with old school. Well, this isn't really that old school, but older graphics. So here we have the the cave where you need to get the sap from the tree during daytime. Look at the lighting coming through the holes in the ceiling of the cave, the way it shines down on the trees and the water. The way it plays with the light, I freaking love this game. I love the beauty of the game. I love the exploration of the game, but this also, to me, sometimes this game is also art. So here we have the tree where we have to get the sap from, with a little ray of sunshine on it. A little butterfly flying around is just... you don't even have to finish the game to enjoy it. You can just walk around and look at everything and just appreciate what the artists have done. So yeah, sometimes even in Skyrim there's art. And here we have an indie game called the Gianna Sisters Twisted Dreams. Here's a little intro. Looks beautiful. Just looks fucking beautiful. I'm sorry, I can't help it. Excuse me. So your sister gets sucked into a vortex and you have to try to save her. Basically that's it. Yeah, this is all levels I finished, but I'm just going back to the first level to show a little bit of the background. And also how many hours they have spent to put all the detail into the background, into the foreground, into the aesthetics of the game. Not the gameplay is pretty simple, just collect gems and you can proceed to the next level. That's basically just a simple platform game, and I love it for it. No pretentious bullshit, no open world bullshit, no fetching bullshit side quests, just go from point A to point B, kill baddies and collect gems. And if you die 3 times or 5 times, well, back to the beginning with you. And when you look at the background, yeah, just have a look at the background and listen to the music, and I will shut up for a bit again, so you will hear me later on. So here is the part where it becomes interesting in the game. With the R2 button, you can change between nightmare and dream. And of course, the layout of the level changes a bit. If you switch, bridges extend or retract, and gates are being closed or opened. But the background also changes. And that's the music also changes. And that to me is also art. This is... art looks so freaking beautiful, just look at it. And if you don't think this is beautiful, it may be too cutesy for you, but the backgrounds look amazing. I have no other words for that, just looks freaking amazing. So again, you could call this art. Not the game itself, but the backgrounds. And maybe even the game itself can be called art, because it's using the mechanic to alter the layout of the level. So also, if you haven't played this game, download it from the store and you'll have a hell of a time. And now we get to the cream of the crop, Fahrenheit, which was added to the PlayStation Store a couple of months ago, and I downloaded it immediately. I wouldn't call this a game, I would call this an experience. And I will shut up now, because there is some dialogue. So
we think we understand the world around us, but we really only see the outside. What it seems to be. I used to be just like you. I believed in humanity, the newspapers, soap commercials, politics, and history books. But one day, the world kicks you in the teeth, and you don't have any choice but to see things the way they really are. My name is Lucas Kane. My story is the one where an ordinary guy has something extraordinary happen to him. Maybe it was supposed to happen. Maybe it was my destiny or my karma or whatever. I know one thing for sure. Nothing's ever going to be the same again.
And of course, this is also what I meant with my PlayStation 4 rants, which I uploaded a couple of months ago. Today, no risks are being taken anymore by any game developer.
It started right here. Where else could it happen? New York. Capital of the universe. The chessboard destiny chose for the last big game. I was just another pawn living my pawn's life. Until that night, when my life descended into chaos.
No more risks are taken today. You know, it's all the same shit, like I said before, all the same open world crap. But this is what I consider art. This game is, like I said, not a game, this is an experience, like The Last of Us was an experience. Heavy Rain was an experience, and this is also an experience. This game really moves you. It's you will be asking constantly what the hell is going on here. And of course you have to finish the game, but it's multi-layered, multiple storylines, multiple endings. Multiple choices. There are some things that, of course, are a bit sucky in this game, like Simon says, action sequences where you have to, those ugly yellow, red, green, blue icons in the middle of the screen, blocking the artwork. That's the only thing I don't like about this game. But for the rest, this game is just, one hell of an experience. This is, for me, the ultimate game to show that games can be art. From the voice acting to the presentation, this is a PlayStation 2 game. This is about, I don't know, 12 years old, 13 years old. And again, good graphics don't make a good game, it's how you use them. It's how you use cliches in games to tell your story, because cliches are used everywhere, every time. It's how you implement them, how you tell your story, how you take the player and take them along an emotional roller coaster, and that's what this game does. You actually feel stressed, you actually feel happy in this game. So yeah, this is the ultimate example of art in video games. And I will leave you with this. I haven't answered the question, I just asked the question and gave my opinion about it. But this game is art. This game should be in a museum on full display every time. All the time. Yeah, maybe in 100 years people will look back and maybe agree with me or not. So I thank you for watching, and I hope I made some sense at least. And you will hear me next time. Goodbye. Thank you.
What have I done?